tonight. Come on, stand with us. We are so glad you're here with us today. Y'all ready to worship the King of Kings? Come on, are you ready? Hallelujah.
I was buried beneath my shame.
Oh, yeah, today is Buddy Barrel, BGNC. Come on right here in the middle, Mr. Barry. Come on in the middle so everybody can see. I forgot. He's reminding me. Today is BGMC, which is Boys and Girls Missions Crusade, to bring your money up. Ready?
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing, but not alive.
I mean, I felt that way.
All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. He called my name. Your mercy has saved my soul.
Yes, it has.
And your freedom is all that I know.
Come on.
The old made new.
Jesus, when I met you, you called my name.
My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. When you call my name,
give Jesus praise. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody shout if he brought you out of that darkness. In- into his glorious light. Amen. You can be seated. Please watch our screen.
Welcome to Bayou Blue Assembly. Listen closely to hear about our upcoming events. This Tuesday is our monthly Men of Standards Fellowship. Come and join us Tuesday night at 6 p.m. for dinner, with service to follow at 7. On Wednesday, August 9th at 10:30, we're going to be having a Prime Timers brunch. If you're a senior citizen, come out and join us, bring a covered dish, and let's just have a time of fellowship together. On Sunday, August 13th at 5 p.m., we'll be having a JBQ parent meeting. If your kid is interested in joining us for JBQ in this next year, make sure that you are there to get all the information that you need. Coming up on August 20th, we are going to be having our Guardian training class again. If you are looking to get involved in ministry and serve right here at Bayou Blue, Guardian training is the first step. So come out on that Sunday night at 4:30 and join us for that. Registration for our Men of Standards 2023 conference, Set Free, is officially open. The conference will be October 27th and 28th, and former Angola pastor Justin Singleton will be coming to preach for us. Registration will be available at the door, but you can pre-register online to get a free conference t-shirt.
Down by 3, 2 seconds left. I live for these moments. Oh man, like a single shot. Been working out here all day. Terrible at basketball, man.
Pastor Dylan, what are you doing?
What do you mean, what am I doing? We're trying to get a basketball goal on the property. I'm just working on my game.
But we don't even have a court. We have to raise money first.
Yeah, raise money. Yeah, that's funny. How in the world are we going to do that, Pastor Michelle?
By eating chicken.
So what, we just go to Cane's, eat chicken, and they give a portion of the sales to Bayou Blue?
Yes, and every first Sunday, they can go to Raising Cane's, purchase a meal, and the percentage will go straight to our project. All they have to do is show a flyer.
So can I go for, like, lunch and dinner?
Yes, all day.
So you're saying I get to eat chicken to get a basketball court on our church property?
That's simple.
That's awesome.
We hope that you join us today at Raising Cane's.
On the east side, please make sure you pray for our team, our national team. Our youth are all coming back from nationals today. Our youth did amazing. They won superiors in a lot of things, are excellent. But I have to announce Jacob, the drummer over here, his daughter Chantel back there, my godchild Faith, won 6 in the nation in sign language, in solo sign language. Isn't that awesome? Number 6, and there's like hundreds of kids participating. There was like 10,000 people there, so we're just excited. So pray for them as they come back. The senior citizen brunch that we're having now, I'm just saying, you have whatever you decide. If you decide that you're a senior citizen, then you're welcome to come. I, however, am not a senior citizen, but I will be there as pastor's wife, just so you know, even though I just had a birthday. I'm not a senior citizen yet, but I am glad to come because I am the pastor's wife. So we want to invite all, if you say you're a senior citizen, then you are welcome to come. Join us, bring a covered dish. We're going to have a great time. One more announcement is the women's Bible study books are in. You can pick them up at the Information Center. We are doing Abide, and maybe you're just catching it. Hey, there's a new Bible study. It doesn't start this Wednesday. It starts next Wednesday. You can go on Amazon and order it. Just let me know, or Miss Mamie or Miss Laura or somebody at the Information Center. Take a picture of the book. Order a book. Come and join us on Wednesday nights at 7 or on Tuesday mornings at 11 o'clock right here. All right? Good? Stand with us. Greet somebody. Let them know you're glad that they are here. Also, you can give. You can give online, or you can give right there in the back. Don't forget to pay your tithe and offering. That's important. I had to go run and put mine in this morning. Number two. Hallelujah. Okay, ready? We trust in him. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we welcome you here in this place, right here in the midst of where we're at. We love you and we praise you. You're an amazing God. Holy Spirit, we welcome you here. Move upon us today, God. touch hearts and lives in this place. Let them know that you are right here, that you care for us, that you love us. Thank you, Jesus.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine.
About his love.
When with the ransom in glory, oh, his face I at last shall see. It will be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me.
Sing it with me one more time.
How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for.
We thank you for your love that so amazes us. Mm.
blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. I'm born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. What He did for me on Calvary's more than enough. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I know the author of tomorrow has ordered my steps. So this is my story, and this is my song. I'm praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior.
Trust in God,
my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God.
Yes, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Glory be to God. I trust in God.
Oh, hallelujah. If God's never failed, you give him a hand clap. Come on. Yes. Glory to you, God. Amen and amen. You may be seated. They told me to watch where I put that microphone because it hisses. I don't know why it hisses. It hisses when I make S's. I'm going to try to preach without an S. Amen. I'm trying. 1 Corinthians 15:51. Just kind of give y'all a heads up this morning. Normally, my scriptures are always in the King James Version. My wife expressed to me, that there were a lot of new people who didn't grow up with the King James Version Bible. And they didn't speak King James. So I found a translation that says it correctly that I can do. And it's the new today's English version. And so if you're following along in your Bible's King James, which I normally read from, and you say, well, that's not what it says. It does say that. It just says it in a little different way. So y'all bear with me. I want to give y'all a warning. Some people are going to go, well, yeah. My Bible don't say that. If you break it down, it does. And so pay attention and listen to me and what I'm going to read. Last service, I quit looking at the scripture and I just was quoting it and I started quoting King James. So I learned all my scriptures in King James. I can't help it. So anyway, 1 Corinthians 15:51, 50, says, listen to this secret truth. We shall not all die, but when the last trumpet sounds, we shall be changed in an instant, as quickly as the blink of an eye. For when the trumpet sounds, the dead will be raised, never to die again, and we shall all be changed. For what is mortal must be changed into what is immortal, and what will die must be changed into what cannot die. So when this takes place and the mortal has been changed into the immortal, then the scripture will come true. Death is swallowed up. Victory is complete. Where death is your victory, where death is the power to hurt. Death gets its power to hurt from sin, and sin gets its power from the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, my dear brothers, stand firm and steady. Keep busy always in your work for the Lord, since you know that nothing you do in the Lord's service is ever useless. Father, I ask that you would help us. Father, I ask that you would touch the heart of the hearer, and that, Lord God, you would allow us to listen to your word, hear your direction. Father, I bind the enemy and anything he would do to come to take away from this moment. Father, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. So we've been focusing in our services on how the Christian is responsible to share the love of God with non-Christians. It is the church's responsibility to go into all the world and make disciples. God did not save any of us so that we could sit on a pew somewhere and watch the world go by, but he called us to come in. And so we went through 4 or 5 weeks talking about what our responsibility is, how we needed to approach the responsibility. And now I want us to talk about the benefit of being a Christian. How many of y'all like benefits? I like benefits. When I was working in the oil field, I always wanted to get me a job that had benefits. You know, because some people paid a little bit more an hour, but they didn't have any benefits. So when I started serving God, I found out that it didn't always pay as much as the world did, but the retirement's out of this world. And so you know, it's okay. You know, you may not get up front what you think you should get in this world, but when you die, you get to go to heaven, and that's pretty cool. So here, as I was looking at the benefits, one of the benefits that I see is what we just finished reading, that there is going to come a time when this old body that carries us around is going to fall down and quit. I don't know if y'all know this, but your physical body is going to die, and it's going to go back to the dirt where it came from. And so this mortal who I am has to come to a place where it puts on immortality. The problem that most of us run into is that we don't understand the things of God. And because we don't understand the things of God, we get confused when things don't go the way we want them to go. We feel like, well, God must be upset with me because my life's falling apart. Anybody ever felt like that, you know, I went to church, I read the Bible, I said a prayer, and my life's still crazy? Well, welcome to normal. The Bible didn't say when you get saved, everything will be perfect. It didn't say that when you give your heart to God, that all the struggles cease. As a matter of fact, I didn't have near as many issues until after I got saved, because I didn't know I was having issues. I was dead in my sin and trespass. I just didn't understand that there was an eternity. I was just trying to survive from one drunk to the next. I just didn't want to die in my sin. I didn't want to suffer the consequence, so I struggled with that. And so I understand that because of human sin, that death entered into the world. See, you have to know that God didn't intend for us to have to go through the death process. He created humanity to live forever, but because Adam and Eve chose to reject God and chose to live in sin, then sin was imputed or passed on to all of humanity, and we, all of us, given a choice, tend to choose sin. Isn't that horrible? You know, no matter how much you're taught that you ought to be, you come to that place and you wind up choosing sin, because sin is a pleasure for a season. Now, there's a consequence that comes with sin after a little while, but sin is pleasure. How many of y'all can be honest enough to say that you sinned because you enjoyed it? Yeah, that's why we sin. We sin because it was fun. I enjoyed it. Now, you know, there are things that I learned. I had to learn through the power and the presence of God that the things in my life were struggling, and I knew that I was headed to an end that was not going to be a good end, because it is appointed unto man once to die, and after this, there's going to be a judgment. So this is the process that we have to come to agree and to understand that when I became a Christian, that I did not set aside that there would be judgment that I would have to deal with. All of us are going to stand and give an account. But if I stand before the great white throne judgment, that's where every sinner is going to stand. All of death and hell are going to give up their grave, and they're going to be there. But see, when I became a Christian, that death, the second death, lost its power over me. Because though it's appointed unto man once to die, after this the judgment. But if you do not die to yourself and accept Jesus as your Savior, then there are two deaths. There is the physical death where the body falls down, and then there is the death that comes when they're cast into the lake of fire, and Revelation says, which is the second death. And so in order for the second death to have no power over you, you have to accept Jesus as your Savior, which means you no longer live by your own will, your own power, or your own rules, but now you walk under the grace and the mercy of God. So what gave death its strength was the law, because the law explained what sin was. We couldn't know what sin was until God gave us a law that said it was wrong. That's how we understand there is no morality in this world without God. There are no absolute rights and wrongs without God. He is the determiner of right and wrong. That's how I know when I've sinned, is because conviction overflows my soul and I recognize that I did what God didn't want me to do. No longer is the law written down in stone tablets, but God has written His law down inside of the heart of His children so that you can know right and wrong. That is God's purpose. So that's what the law came to do. And so death had its power because my whole life was based upon sin and punishment. As a sinner, you're bound to the law of sin and death. How many know that? That's pretty self-explanatory, isn't it? You sin, you die. And so as a sinner without Christ Jesus, that was the driving factor of my life, that because I sinned, I was going to die. But Jesus came, He died on the cross, and His death was my substitutionary sacrifice. So instead of me having to die for my sin, Jesus did. So that's how death lost its power over the church, because Jesus paid the price. So we know in Revelations that Jesus went into the bowels of the earth, came back with the keys of death, hell, and the grave. Death lost its authority over those who choose Jesus. Now, some of y'all may be thinking, this is so basic, Pastor. Hang on, we're going to get deeper. But we got to start in the shallow end. We're not going to jump off of the deep end. We don't want to leave nobody. So the process that we're doing is we're understanding. You were a sinner and you earned death. Jesus died on a cross. Your life intersects with that, right? We come to that crossroad of Calvary, my will, God's will. And so I come to Jesus. Someone told me that He loved me so much and didn't want me to have to die, that He died for me so that I could have life now, more abundant. Not just a hope for the future, but a hope for now. Now, that ought to excite somebody, because that hope that's deferred is fine, but I need some hope now. I need some strength now. I need some courage now, not just later. It's okay that there was a great move of God back then, and it's great that there's going to be heaven up there, but I'm living right now, right? You're going through your struggle right now. So now is when it's important for you to understand that Jesus died and took away death's power over you, so you don't have to be afraid of death. You don't have to be afraid of your future. You don't have to be afraid of the consequences of your past coming back on you. Because isn't that a struggle many of us have, that I know I did wrong things, and because I did wrong things, there are going to be these consequences. The preachers are always preaching, sowing and reaping. There are consequences. You messed up, you're going to get it. You say, well, are you going to contradict that? No, I'm going to correct that. If I believe that Jesus died on a cross in payment for humanity's sin, and I do, whose sin is excluded in that? Is my sin excluded because I should know better? No. He died once for all, right? So the sin has been paid for those who are saved. Why? Because now that I'm a Christian, I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus. Old things are passed away. Behold,
Some things have become new. Oh, no, it doesn't say some, does it? It says all things have become brand new. So if I believe that the Bible is God's word, and I do, then I have to believe that the payment for my sin fell on someone else, because I'm no longer guilty, because I'm not who I used to be. I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus. It is through Jesus that I have the victory to do what he called me to do. It is through Jesus Christ that you have the ability not to sin. You didn't even have the ability not to sin before Christ. You struggled, and sometimes you got it right, but like the old saying, even a blind hog finds an acorn every now and then. You know, it's not because you purposed it, not because you planned it. It just fell that way that you maybe done the right thing, but it wasn't because it was purposed. But as a Christian, as a child of God, I'm no longer bound to the punishment of my past. Now I am free in Christ Jesus, so I don't deserve the junk that's going on. There is a difference in the mentality. As a child of God, I have been set free from the penalty, spiritually speaking, of what I was. Now, you broke laws in this world, you may have to pay for that. But God doesn't hold that against you anymore, because Jesus paid the price for that sin. So this is a process that so many people get tied up in, is that I can't do something for God because of what I was or because of what I've been, because I knew better and messed up anyway. God can't use me. But that's not what it said. It said, matter of fact, that you continue to do God's will in the understanding that you're working for God is never in vain. It always accomplishes something, whether you can see it or not. I remember one day I was working offshore. I had gone back. It was after I'd graduated or got out of Bible college. I got married, worked free for a while for a church in Gina, my dad's. And I went back offshore, and we were on the rig, and I didn't know anybody that was on the rig, and there was a guy with four of us, two room bunk beds, and a guy right across from me caught my view, and we started talking about God. They asked me who I was, where I was from, so I started talking about salvation, started talking about God, started talking about forgiveness and grace and mercy, and we talked for probably 35 or 40 minutes, and when we got done, I was really ready for this guy to say, you know what, I want to be a Christian. He said, well, good night, flipped the light off. I said, oh, well, okay. So I turned my light off, went to bed. The next day, I was up in the front of the rig, and I was doing something, and a guy walked up and said, hey, Packy. I said, yeah. He said, did you, all that stuff y'all were talking about last night, did you mean all that? Is that real? I said, well, yeah, it's real. He said, could I get saved? I need Jesus. My life's messed up. I said, come here. I grabbed right there in front of God and everybody. I stopped and prayed. He said a sinner's prayer with me. And I said, you know what? I never even knew he was listening. Amen. So you don't understand and you don't know what's going on or who's listening or who's around you. That's why we always continue doing what God called us to do, because God's in control of where you are, not you. God's always leading people into your path that you never expected, people that you'll make a difference in their life, even though you don't know, because one plants a seed, one pours water, but God, he brings an increase in someone's life. I don't know about anybody in here, but there was more than one person involved in me getting right. There was a lot of people that threw a lot of seed. Some of them even fertilized me a little bit. I could have probably let that go. But God brought the increase into my life when he was ready to do the work that needed to be done, but he used people who I intersected with, right? People that came across. Some of them I only knew for a short period of time. Others are still in my life. But the work that they did in the beginnings, God used those things to change who I was on the inside and caused me to be changed from glory to glory into His image. Now, I want you to know that there's a lot of stuff that's still happening in my life. And there are times when I don't feel like I've got much of a victory going on. There are times when I look around and I see all the hand of the enemy coming against me, and you see what looks like the waves of life, just one billowing after the next, and you look at that and you think, you know, I just don't know. Certainly, there must be something going on with me. I need to repent of something. I need to ask God to forgive me of something, because how can it be so hard when everybody else seems like it's so easy to serve God? You got to love folks like that, right? You know, when you get saved, it'll all be good. It'll be sunshine and rainbows all the time. Everybody will love you. Just say this prayer with us. How many of y'all know that's not true? After I got saved, the devil kicked me in the teeth. He did. Kicked me right down. And he used church people to do it. Because sometimes church people forget who they are. And some of us think that being a mule is good. And so I found myself in that place, but it was a struggle that made me feel like I couldn't go on. I couldn't be part of the church because I wasn't good enough to be part of the church. Because after all, when I looked in that mirror and I saw me, I know me. I know my weaknesses. I know my struggles. I know the times when I shouldn't think what I'm thinking and times when I ought not slap people. And it's in me to want to do it. And I think, you know, how can you want to slap somebody and it be okay? And it's not. And I know it's not. And I know I shouldn't. But you know what? It's there sometimes. And people just get on your last nerve. Is it just me? Oh, whew. I'm preaching in the right place today. People just get on your last nerve, and you come to church, and everybody's smiling, and they're all saying, I'm blessed, I'm blessed. And they lying. But you don't know they lying. And so you think, I don't belong in this place with all these holy people. Stay a little bit longer, get to know them. You'll think, man, this is like coming home, you know? All family here. But it's a struggle that we get into because if you're honest, if you're an honest person, you're going to say, I mess up. I have bad days. The things that I want to do, I can't seem to make myself do. The things that I hate, I do. Y'all, there's a war that's raging inside of all of us. But you know what? I have victory. Not through my education, not through my willpower. I have victory through Christ Jesus. That is the hope. Yes, amen. That is the hope that we grip. It's not a religious understanding of this. It's not an organization. It's not, for heaven's sakes, don't hang on to me to get through. Because y'all ain't dragging me down with you. Right? I hope. You got to reach out, get a hold to Jesus, because He is the power of the resurrection and the hope and the anointing that breaks that yoke of sin. Not anybody else, not anything else in this world can do that, but that's okay because we do it in Christ Jesus through Him. So what does that mean? That means that I have to stop allowing how I feel to determine where I live. Because when you don't feel like you're something, then you live in condemnation. You live in a bad place, you know, where the devil shows up and starts lying to you, and you believe that. We see in Romans, the 8th chapter, the 35th verse says, "Who then can separate us from the love of Christ? Can trouble do it, or hardship, or persecution, or hunger, or poverty, or danger, or death? As the scripture saith, for your sake we are in danger of death at all times. We are treated like sheep that are going to the slaughter. No, in all these things we have complete victory through him who loved us. For I am certain that nothing can separate us from his love, neither death nor life, neither angels nor other heavenly rulers or powers, neither the present nor the future, neither the world above nor the world below. There is nothing in all creation that will ever be able to separate us from the love of God, which is ours through Christ Jesus our Lord." Isn't that powerful? Nothing can say. So he asked the question, maybe because you don't have money, God's punishing you. After all, isn't that how everybody seems to want to say, I got money, I must be doing good? I know a lot of people got money not doing good. And the more money they get, the worse they do. You ever wonder why God keeps some people poor? Because he can't trust them with money. One thing money won't do is make you evil. It just opens up the opportunity for you to be evil. You know, before I had a job and had money, I didn't go do drugs and alcohol. I didn't do all that. Couldn't afford it. Got me a job, got me some money though. I could. And I loaded up on all that stuff. It wasn't me making money made me that. Miss Brenda, I was wanting to do it the whole time. And you find in friends with money, I didn't have to pay for it. I was able to indulge. But it wasn't because of money. But does money separate you from God's love? Does a lack of money, does poverty, I'm in poverty, God doesn't love me anymore? No, that's not true. Those are not the places where we judge whether or not there's love for us, toward us, from God. The way that I gauge whether or not I am loved by God is in the Bible. The Bible says, "For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." My love from God to me is not based upon anything else in this world. It's based upon the Bible. And the Bible says, I am loved. So it doesn't matter if I'm going through difficult times. Think about Peter walking on the water. Jesus loved him enough to let him walk on the water. When Peter took his eyes off Jesus and sank, do you think God hated him? If you do, then you didn't read the Bible, because it says, while he's going down, he had enough sense. Jesus, save me. And Jesus reached down immediately and pulled him up. It had nothing to do with his great faith that had love for him from God. Jesus loved him, and Jesus honored his request, but Jesus didn't get mad and quit loving him because he failed. Now, you ain't got to raise your hand this time, because everybody would qualify, and some too proud. But after you were saved and you failed, how many of us let the devil separate us from God? He didn't separate you from God's love. He separated you from God because he lied to you and made you think that because of what you did, God can't love you. And y'all, that's not true. It's just not true. Turn that down. Up. Turn off. Just for a little while. I see people are shivering out there. I'm good. I don't want everybody to be cold. I want y'all to pay attention. And if y'all freezing to death, you ain't paying attention. If you're hot, I'm sorry. If you're cold, thank you. You're welcome. And so here I am trying to reconcile, right? I'm a Christian. I'm serving God, but I messed up. Yeah, that's right. You can be a Christian, you can love God, and you can mess up. It doesn't mean you didn't love God. It doesn't mean you weren't a Christian. Don't let the devil lie to you and say, if you really love God, you wouldn't do that. If you really love God, you wouldn't get mad. If you really love God, you wouldn't think about hurting somebody. If you really love God, you'd never have a bad thought. You know, that's not biblical. Why do you think he said take every thought into captivity? If once you're saved, you don't have bad thoughts. Because you have to take every thought into captivity, because there are bad thoughts that come at you. The devil will tempt you in one ear and accuse you in the next. He'll tell you, oh, look over there. I can't believe you looked over there. Where's Joshua at? He's somewhere in here. We were at Mardi Gras Outreach one time, and I'm not going to call the preacher's name, but we were there, and we were getting ready. Our SUM students were going out witnessing, telling people about Jesus. And Joshua says, look at that woman naked. And this preacher went. And he said, look at him, look, look at him, look. I said, boy, you are bad. Oh, he embarrassed that poor old guy. So I had to get on to Joshua while I was laughing. But y'all, the devil does that to you. He'll tell you something and you think about it and he goes, I can't believe you're a Christian thinking like that. Oh man, I must not be saved. Being tempted is not a sin. The Bible says that Jesus was tempted at every level but never sinned. There's a separation there. Being tempted is not the sin. Giving in to temptation, that's the sin. But see, the devil wants to separate you from God by the battles and the destruction of all that's going on around you. Well, if I'm going through these hardships, did God really give me victory? Yes. I don't walk by my victory until I get to the other end of the battle. The problem is we judge things too early. Somebody comes and gets saved, and God touched their hearts and they're saved. A couple of months down the road, they mess up. And what does the church say? I knew they weren't going to last. See, there it wasn't real. But I'm going to tell you something. It took me, I forget sometimes, and God reminds me. Because when I tell the story, I went from being a sinner to a saint. You know, I was drinking, I cussed, and I did, and God changed me and changed me, and praise God, I'm not that anymore. God says, yeah, it took a couple of years, son. Oh, I forgot. It didn't happen overnight. I'd be minding my own business. Somebody made me mad, and I'd cuss at them. And then I'd think, wait a minute, I don't do that no more. Where, I don't know where that came from. I preached a message offshore. Some of my guys, I was having Bible study. And I said, from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You want to know where that cuss word came from? Came from your heart. Had it been in you, couldn't have got out. Boy, I had an organ, huh? I could preach. But that's the thing. The thing is the recognition of that is because I had a cuss word left in me doesn't mean I'm not saved. It just means God wants to reveal to me I've got still stuff to work on. Don't quit serving God because you ain't got all the discipline you're supposed to have at the moment you got saved. My daddy baptized somebody and his hair wouldn't go under. So dad kept pushing. A guy, he must have had hair that long. I don't know, but hairspray, it wasn't going down. But dad kept pushing. Finally, he let the old boy up, and he come up cussing. And then apologizing. He just wasn't sanctified holy. He got saved. It wasn't done. It was a progressive work, you know. But it didn't. He stayed with Jesus. He's in heaven today. But I mean, he had a rough start. First off, the preacher tried to drown him, you know. He's thinking, good night. But that's that process. And how many of y'all know that you're not perfect in your own action, but you are in Christ Jesus? His blood covers you. He paid for your sin. It is through Him, right, that love can flow. It's not because of your goodness. It's because of His goodness that His love is extended to you. You say, yeah, but what if I mess up 100 times? Jesus said to Peter, 7 times 70 in a day, if someone sins against you and asks for forgiveness, to forgive them. How many of y'all think that if He said you should, He could? If He couldn't, that would have been just a cruel thing to do. But because God can, He can forgive you every time you're truly sorry. His forgiveness flows. And now, you know, unlike God, I can't see your heart. So when somebody wrongs me, I'll forgive them. But the next time they draw back, I duck. You know, I didn't forget. Someone told me one time, said, you have to forgive and forget. I said, nope. I got to forgive. Ain't nowhere in the Bible says I got to forget. I'm gonna learn to dodge your punches. You trying to hit me? Uh-uh. I'm gonna stay out of hand's length away from you. You bad for slapping. I'm not gonna get close to you to slap. That don't mean I didn't forgive you. It just means I ain't dumb. Right? How many of y'all, it's okay to be practical? We try to be so super spiritual is what gets you in trouble. Oh, I'm saved now. Sin can't ever affect me again. You're still the same person that was bound by that sin a week ago. Do you think you're going to relearn everything like that? It just doesn't happen that way. Yeah, you're a new creature, and God saved you. And if you die in this moment, you get to go to heaven. But He's not going to leave you where you are. It's not like God says, well, I, that's where I found Him. I guess I got to leave Him there. He loves you too much to leave you in your mess. It keeps moving. I'm trying to keep it in the right place. So here I see this law that's at work with me. That I know that if I bring my struggles to God, He doesn't throw me away. But He cares about me. So He cares about my struggles. Anybody in here love somebody? Some of y'all don't love nobody. Has anybody in here ever loved somebody enough to love what they loved even though you didn't care? You got mamas and daddies who get married, and the mother has children, or the father has children, and the stepmother, stepfather loves those kids like they were their own. They do that because they love the spouse. Now, they may eventually do it because of the kid, right? But they do it initially because of the love for the person, right? So God loves me, so He loves the things I love. Not the sinful things, but the good things. And so God takes care of what I care about because He loves me. And so you need to get a hold of that, because we think that when bad things happen to stuff that we love, that that's just a consequence of God not being mad or God. But y'all, the enemy's attacking. He hates you. So in regards, he hates your stuff. He hates what you love. So he's attacking it. But as a Christian, I am able to engage the devil in warfare through Jesus Christ, not through my power, not through my strength or my weakness, but through the power and the anointing of God. I step into the battle and I go to war because God loves me. Because Jesus already won the battle, and He conquered sin, death, and hell. And so the scripture that says, I am more than a conqueror, It's not because I'm more than Jesus. It's because Jesus did all the fighting and won all the battles, and I get to walk in all the victory. Right? That makes me more than that. So I'm not bound by what I was. I think about when I think about the prodigal son, it sticks with me because I relate heavily to him. Because I knew God when I was young. And then I made some really bad choices in life. And I wound up as far away from God as you could possibly get. I mean, I went into the far country. I took everything that I had with me, and I went into some riotous living. Everything my dad preached against, I found a way to do, because I was determined it must be fun, because they just tried to ruin my fun growing up all the time. I tried to fly. They told, no, you can't fly. Showed them. Well, I tried to. They actually were right. I couldn't. Both times. You know, you always got to do twice just to make sure. But I found myself on the other side of sin and away from God. And I lost everything. And I found myself in a place that stunk. An old pig pen. Mud, nasty garbage. And I was living in that little garbage dump. Living in that filth. Living like that. And I felt like, well, you know what? I'm just getting what I got coming. Anybody ever felt that way? You just getting, I mean, you asked for it. You got it. Deal with it, right? That's how I felt. I brought it on myself. Nobody to blame but me. I'm sitting there, and all the stuff I knew about God's grace and God's mercy and God's forgiveness, I knew all of it. I've sat there and thought to myself, man, you know, I know God loves. And I'd have sinners would ask me, well, you know, I say, it's okay. God can forgive you. Go back. And I'm sitting in my pig pen telling everybody else about the love of God and the grace of God and the mercy of God. And I'm sitting there saying, well, I just got this coming. I mean, I knew better, and I did this. But one day, just like the prodigal, nothing in his life changed. And so Scripture says, and he got up. Stop sitting there feeling sorry for yourself. Stop sitting there knowing all the things you ought to do, knowing all the truth that belongs to you. Get up. It's time to get up and start back to the house. It's time to get up and start back to God. One of the most glorious parts of the story is that when he's yet a far distance from the house, the father sees him coming. And he didn't throw rocks at him. He didn't wait till he got there and say, see there, I told you, boy. If you'd have listened to me, you could have saved your money and your life would be better. He said the father ran to him, threw his arms around his neck, laid his head on his shoulder and cried and said, praise God, this my son who was dead is alive. Y'all, he glorified God for the return of his son. Y'all, your heavenly father loves you so much that when you do make bad choices, it's okay. Go home. Go home and make it right. You say, yeah, but Pastor, how do I know I can win? I'm glad y'all asked. 1 John 5:4 says, because every child of God is able to defeat the world, and we win the victory over the world by means of our faith. Who can defeat the world? Only the people who believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Right? Do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God? Then you can defeat the world. The world is Satan and all of his schemes and all of his plans. You can win if you're a child of God. And because I'm a child of God, and I am a child of God, that is the benefit of being a Christian, is that you are a child of God. You are responsible not to win the battle, but to enter the battle. You have to be willing to go to war and then let God fight the battle. I make declarations as a Christian, I will no longer give in to this stuff. When that stuff comes at me, I don't give in to it. I go to war with it. I go to war against Satan. I go to war against the lie. I go to war against the enemy. I go. Now, I understand that there are times that I become weary. And in the very presence of my enemy, my God will prepare a table before me. Give me a little bit of food. Some seafood gumbo. Shrimp okra, that's what I'm having for lunch today. As long as y'all behind me in the line, I don't care. But the Father prepares in the very prayer. He doesn't wait till you finally drag yourself out of your mess. He just plops down right there next to you, sets up a table, says, come here, let's get something to eat. You look like you're tired. Isn't that great that we have a Father that cares about us, a Father that wants to take care of us? That's who we have. But y'all, we got to go into this. You got to make a decision. I'm not going to quit. And because I'm not going to quit, I can't lose. The devil can't win. I'm not quitting. And as long as I'm in the battle, God's fighting for me. And if God be for me, Janet, you can come. If God be for me, who can be against me? Now, the answer to that is nobody. When I stand with God, I win. I don't know where everybody's life has been. Don't know all the things maybe you've been through. But I'm going to tell you, if you're like me, I love God. I loved God when I first got saved with everything inside of me. And I blew it. But you know what? I didn't want to blow it. I hated that I blew it. And I would find myself praying and asking God to forgive me, but not believing He would. Because why should He? Right? And in my own honest heart, because I didn't take into account the Bible, because I didn't know enough of the Bible. I was trying to learn it, but I didn't know enough of it. But as I learned more of the Bible and I began to put more of the Bible inside of me, my confidence in God's ability to keep me grew. That's why it's so important to read your Bible. That's why it's so important to pray and to talk to God and to surround yourself with people who pray and read their Bible. If you surround yourself with dope smoking drunks, you know what you're going to become? A dope smoking drunk. You're going to become who you're around all the time. If you're getting all your advice from people who don't know God, then you're never going to get advice about God. But if you will find people who read their Bible and pray, not perfect people, none of us would qualify. But people who read their Bible and pray and love God, then when you're going through difficulty, you'll find somebody that understands. Somebody that feels your pain. Somebody that understands your struggle. Who won't tell you, oh, well, that's not as bad as some stuff. Oh, well, that's not that big a deal. But instead put their arm around you and say, hey, you can win. We'll fight together. We'll bind up together. You know, the Bible says that a friend loves at all times. But brothers are born for adversity. I love that scripture. Because you know what? I love my friends. But I have brothers that gang around me. Strap up, get ready. Because if we go to war, my brothers are going to fight with me. It was a confirmation of a dream that Sister Hannah had about an attack here in the church that a snake came down this aisle, a big snake. And I ran down to fight the snake because you know, that's what we do. And I grabbed it too low, and a snake bit me on my arm. And she said, all the people were running away, said, until that moment. And when that snake bit me, my brothers ran to me and helped me grab the snake. And we drug that snake out of the charge, and we defeated it. Because you know what? None of us stand alone. Not one person in here stands alone, not and wins the victory. We need our brothers. We need our sisters. We need our family to stand with us. But more than anything else, I need Jesus. See, if Jesus is for me, I'm going to be okay. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If our prayer team would make their way here to the front, please, and just get ready. We're gonna have y'all come in a minute. But if you're here this morning and you would say, Pastor, I'm really been going through some struggles. I've really been going through some hard times. And I really need God to give me strength because I'm really not winning this battle, but I want to. If that's you, just slip your hand up and say, just pray for me. I see the hands. Thank y'all. Would you stand your feet all across the building? Heavenly Father, you saw the hands and you know the heart. Lord God, I come against the lies of hell. I come against the attacks of the enemy. And Lord God, I loose your strength and your power into the heart of your people. That, Lord God, we don't stand on our own. We don't stand in this world's strength. But God, we stand in yours. So Father, we just yield ourselves to you. And we ask that you would just touch us and draw us into deeper places. I bind the enemy and the name of Jesus, and Father God, we loose your power in Jesus' name. If you need prayer, someone to agree with you, you have other things that are going on in your life, and you just need somebody to pray, would you make your way to the front? We'll pray for you, and we'll do it, and God will move on your behalf.